Hello, this is Jose Luis here at Parametric Camp, and welcome to another video in our mini series, How to Use the DALL-E API. In this video, I would like to teach you how to use the DALL-E API directly from the terminal, how to request an image prediction from the command line, okay? And in order to do that, you should have watched my previous videos on what the DALL-E API is and how to get your API key. All right, so I assume that at this point you have your key and you have set it up as an environment variable, as we did in the previous videos, okay? So how are we going to do this? Well, the idea here is that if we go to the documentation and if we look at image generation, we can go directly to the image generation endpoint. Endpoint means anywhere on an API where you can get a query through and then you can get a response. And what we can see is that creating an image basically boils down to creating what's called a post request, an HTTP post request, to this particular endpoint here. The endpoint being a URL with a bunch of versions and subcategories and like then all the breadcrumbs all the way through. And in the body of that request, make sure that you input all the mandatory information and all the optional one if you want to customize that request. So the documentation as of this recording in November 7th, 2022, if you're watching this from the future, this might be obsolete already. But as of this recording, you can see that the API already gives you examples how to do that in Python using their custom module and in Node.js also using their custom module, which we will see how to do in next videos in this series. But you can see that if you scroll here, you have an option to do it with curl. And curl, or C-U-R-L, is basically this command, I guess, that you can use to do post request and get requests directly from the terminal. So this is what we're going to be using today. And you can see that in the description, it already gives you an example of all the headers that you need to add and what is the data that you need to pass as the body of your request. So we're going to see an example of how to do that. I'm going to dock this here to the side and I'm going to right click. I have the new Windows terminal installed here on my system, but I'm going to do examples of Windows and for non-Windows system. I'm actually going to start with non-Windows systems because I have here installed the Windows subsystem for Linux, the WSL. So if you already know me, I'm not a huge Mac lover, but I have to admit that Macs and Linux having Bash is definitely something that is amazing. So if you're a Windows user, I very strongly recommend you install WSL, Windows Subsystem for Linux, because that gives you access to working on your Windows machine with Linux-like commands, which is what we're going to be doing today. All right, so if we follow the prompt or the example in the API, you can see that it boils down to basically writing on your terminal something of this kind. Of this kind, which is a long command request with all these parameters. Just keep in mind that we don't need the backslashes. Backslashes in Bash just means a new line. So we can just write the whole thing as a one liner. So the way we're going to do that is I'm going to write, for example, curl, and then I'm going to say HTTPS, and then images create image here, images and generations. I was in the wrong place. And then so images / generations. Okay, so now I have the URL. I need to add two headers to my post request. The first one is going to be that the content of this request is going to be a JSON file so that the app, when it gets the data in, it knows that it's formatted as a JSON object. The other header that I need to add is going to be the header with my API key. So I'm going to do it the bad way, which is that I'm going to actually write the API key here, authorization, bearer, and then I'm just going to copy and paste the API key that I just created in my previous video, which is terrible practice, but I will get back into that, okay? And then we need to write here the data for the prompt that we want to pass in, okay? What does this look like? Well, it looks like something like this. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to copy paste from something that I created before. And it's like here under data, you basically have to write a JSON object with all these double quotes, for example, and with the following properties. I want to have a prompt, and the prompt is going to be an isometric view of a miniature city, tilt shift, bokeh, voxel, V-ray render, high detail. Then I want to specify how many images do I want. In this case, I'm just going to request one image. Maybe I can actually change that. Let me get two images, all right? Then the size is going to be 256 by 256. And then I need to close the curly bracket and I need to close the with a single quote. And literally, that's it. If I were to press enter now, what you can see is that my system is now talking to the OpenAI model, all right, is requesting an image, and then we got a response. This that you see here is the response. What you can see is that I got a JSON object as a response, which has the date, the Unix timestamp of when was it created, the data that is created, and the data is basically an array with the two URLs of the images that were generated. So if I now click on this URL, you can see that it takes me to the image that I just generated, which is this kind of like nice miniature city. And then if I click here again, I also generate another image, which is pretty cool. All right. So now I have the two URLs of these two images. So now I can downclick, I can download and save this image, etc. Or I can, for example, say, well, you know what? I want one image, but I want it like full resolution. So what I want here is I want 124 by 124. And then I'm going to request this. I'm going to wait for the response to go through. And then you can see that this is the response that I just got from the server. And if I click here, I now get a full fledged 124 by 124 image at a much higher resolution. I'm not zooming in right now. This is the resolution that I'm getting from the image, okay? Which is also pretty cool, huh? Something that we may want to consider is looking at the actual documentation. So you can see that in the body, when we write this whole data body, there are several things that we need to add. So we need to make sure that there's a prompt with the text. We need to add the parameter n, which tells us how many images we generate. And you can see that we have a maximum of 10 images. The size, as per the documentation, is limited to either 256, 512, or 1024 square images. We cannot get 16 by 9. We cannot get any of that. And then the response format, which is something that we will work on very soon, is that when you generate the images, you can either get the result as an URL, so as a link that I can go to and then I can download the image, or I can get it in base64 JSON. What that means is that what we get back is the actual data of the images, of the image, encoded in base64 format. For the case study of the terminal, it's not very useful, but we're definitely going to be using this when we write apps that want the full image because we want to render it or because we want to save it somewhere locally. Okay, so this one is going to be very useful. And a string and the user, this one is optional. This is if you're actually writing apps where people, different people, will be creating their own images and you want to make sure that they're not abusing the system. So OpenAI will have a way to figure out if a particular user is requesting too many images and ban that user from, or stop that user from requesting too much. Okay, so this is for you to just add some kind of ID representing the user and making sure that the same user is not continuously requesting images and giving you a super high bill to pay for all these requests. Okay, beautiful. So something that I want to make sure is that as I said before, using hard-coded or API keys on your bash commands is not a good practice. Something that is very common is to generate a variable, for example, that I'm going to call OpenAI API key and store that variable in here, right? What that means now is that Well, because WSL is not connected to my Windows environment variables. In order to do that, it's kind of tricky. So I have to manually do this like this. But if I do that, now what I can do is that I can just say, well, I can use curl with my URL, content type, authorization, and then you can see that here I am linking to a variable called OpenAI API key, which is the one that I just defined before, and then I'm getting this prediction here. All right. So in this way, I'm just using a variable as opposed to hard coding there, and I get another prediction. Wow, this one is nice, huh? And I get another prediction. I like this background, like up. All right. And then the last thing perhaps that I want to show is that when you're doing this from the terminal, getting a printout of the response on the screen is nice. But if you're writing automated scripts, maybe you actually want to save that somewhere. So if I use the same command, I'm going to press the up key to repeat the same command. And what I do is that I type the response using the greater than symbol to a file called, for example, response.txt. What will happen is that instead of getting a printout on the terminal, I will get a file on my system with that response printed out. So if I minimize this and I bring the file on focus here, you can see that now I'm going to I'm going to open that file in Visual Studio, and you can see that I basically have the JSON object here, and I can now click and show the image that I just generated. Okay, beautiful. So this is great if you have access to either a Linux subsystem, like the one that I'm using here in Windows, or if you have a Mac, or if you have a Linux machine, which have Bash by default in their terminal. If you don't, you probably have to stick to the Windows way of doing this, which will probably be with PowerShell, but I can show you how to do that with PowerShell. Let me show you that in a second. Let's go to my desktop, and I'm going to open here a Windows PowerShell terminal. All right. So in PowerShell, we actually do have curl, but it's kind of weird because it's kind of this like alias for what's happening inside, which is actually this command called invoke request, web request. So it's kind of confusing that it's called the same, but it uses different parameters. So I don't like to use that at all. So what we're going to do is we're actually going to write it manually. So in Windows PowerShell, you would use what's called invoke web request. Then I'm going to write here the full URL of the API. So that's going to be api.openai.com/version1/images/generations. Okay, I'm looking at my cheat sheet on the other monitor. And then after that, you have to specify similar parameters to the ones that we have here. It's just that you write them with slightly different parameters. So for example, the headers, you say, I'm going to pass the content type, and that's going to be application/JSON. Then I also need to add a method and specify that the method is going to be a post request. All right, that's very important. Post is, for those of you who may not, post is the any request that comes with data as part of the request. And then I also need to add to the headers, I need to add for the authorization token, which is going to be something like this. So I'm going to add authorization, and then that's going to be equal to open parentheses and then bearer. And then because I have on my system the API key that I already stored as part of my environment variables, then what I can do is, like similar to the video before, I can just say from environment, I want to pick up openai.api.key. And again, this is because I already stored my key as an environment variable. You can see my previous video on how to do that. Okay, I'm going to close double quotes. I'm going to close curly brackets. And then now that I have everything, the post request, the headers, the content type, etc., now comes the body of the request. What is the data that I'm going to send? And that data is basically going to see, is going to, and why, and this data is basically going to see the JSON object, this JSON object here, but as we did before, written as a one-liner. So I'm just going to copy and paste from what I did before, single quotes. I'm going to use single quotes so that inside I can use double quotes for the prompt, I can use double quote for the parameter and for the size, all right? And then once I have that, I believe that this should work. So let me show you. I'm going to do this, and then it's doing the post request, it's taking a few seconds, et cetera, et cetera. And then I should get the full response from the request. Now, what you can see is that by doing this with PowerShell, what I actually get is a full description of all the data that I get with the response. But typically, what I'm only interested is in the content that I'm getting that I want from that response. So what I can do is, and this is kind of bad because this content is kind of cut down. I cannot see the full URL. So something that I can do is I can pipe my response. So I can write the same comment, the same command. And then what I can do is I can use vertical pipe, which is the PowerShell way of piping things. And I can say that I want to select an object from this response and that I want to expand that object. And that object is going to be the content part of the request. So if I do this, what I will get is another response, but on the printout here, you see what I'm getting in the terminal is now the extended full text of the content of the response for the post request, okay? And if I want to save that to some file, what I can do is, for example, I can remove this and instead of printing it, what I can do is I can say set content from, set content from the what is coming, and then the path is going to be to this file that I'm going to call response from powershell.txt. And as I do that, that response showed up in my other monitor, so I'm going to drag it all the way here, and you can see response PowerShell is now the JSON file with the link for the image that I just generated, okay? Beautiful. All right. So this is great now. So now you have a sense of what making a post request and this technique that I just used, you can use it to create post requests to any service and any API because they all use the same underlying technology. It's just like the properties and the JSON file and the body of the request changes slightly depending on their documentation, but it's very similar. Okay. Beautiful. As nerdy and as interesting as this might be, this is not very useful unless you're writing automated bash scripts to do things under the hood. But if you actually want to write applications in Python, Node, etc., the way you have to execute this post request is slightly different. So I would like to show you how to do that in the next videos. So join me in the next video where I think I'm going to start by doing this in Python. Okay, let's see how to use the DALL-E API in Python on the next video. See you there. Bye bye.